Hello everyone. So the next topic is on automatic text summarization. So humans can consolidate textual information from multiple sources and organize the content into a coherent summary. Can machines be thought to do the same? The most important obstacles facing multi-document summarization include excessive redundancy in source content, ambiguous sentence construction, and the shortage of training data. So I'd like to welcome Mr. Saurav Ghosh. Saurav is a senior content and community lead at Adobe Bangalore. With more than a decade years of industry experience, Saurav is interested in enhancing content performance and optimization using machine learning and other predictive algorithms. In his current role, Saurav uses NLP and automation to extract trends and mine important information from customer data. Saurav is a regular speaker in R and Python conferences and meetup, and is a founding member of Bangalore R Users Group. So a big round of applause to Saurav Ghosh.
Thank you everyone. Am I audible to people in the back? You can hear, right? Good. So, you know, I mean, in conferences, so, you know, Murphy's law, so whatever can go wrong, will go wrong. So, whatever conferences that I have spoken in the past, there always have been some issues with the mic or the presentation. So if anything goes wrong, just, you know, ignore that. So here I am. So whatever I'm going to talk about for the next 30 odd minutes or so, I'd like to make it as interactive as possible. So that's why I have the slides that I prepared. It's not the greatest. So whatever template that they gave me, I just put my stuff on that. So this is a repurpose of a talk that I presented in Chennai last month at PyCon. So there it was a completely different set of audience, and here it's a completely different set of audience. So when you talk about automatic text summarization, what do you have in mind? I mean, can anyone tell me? Yep. Right. So we see text summarization like everywhere. Okay. The app called InShorts that we have. So it summarizes the news content in like 60 words or less. Right. Reddit, whatever items in Reddit, whatever subreddits that you go to, again they summarize it. So just little info about myself. So my name is Saurav, of course. So I am a big Star Wars fan, have been since childhood. I'm a diehard supporter of Manchester United. Thank you. So I was privileged enough to watch a match at Old Trafford a couple of years ago. So that's how big a fan I am. I'm passionate about R, the language, passionate about statistics and data science. Big fan of Breaking Bad. Probably I am one of the biggest fans of Breaking Bad. And of course, my favorite band, Led Zeppelin. So anyone here Led Zeppelin here? Awesome, great. So I'm a big fan of Led Zeppelin. So so again, whatever I had given to Sufyan, it's just, you know, I put it here. So that's how badly I was prepared for the presentation. In fact, that was my own fault. I kind of repurposed it, whatever I spoke last month in Chennai. So, you know, the main theme is, so I'll go over the slides, but want to make it more interactive. I want your opinion. I'll ask questions. Whatever, if you want to ignore any slide, go ahead. Okay, I'm not big on slides, actually. I mean, PowerPoint is one of the worst things to happen in the industry. So any whatever presentations you do in PowerPoint, 80% of them have no sense, makes no sense. Okay. So again, for example, we as human beings, we have our own intelligence. We have developed some amount of intelligence from childhood till or adulthood. So whenever we see a piece of information, a piece of content, a news content or a blog or whatever you say, we are inherently taught to summarize it. As millennials, our attention span is no less than 2.8 seconds. So what would I do? What should I do to address that section of the society? I don't have time to read an 800 word blog. Nobody has the time. We can't expect anyone to do so. But as humans, we are taught to, that happens in conferences again, right? So as humans, we are taught to, you know, just skim the content. I'm sure you have done that like n number of times. We are taught to skim the content and, you know, interpret whatever we want to do so from that content, get our own interpretation out in the world. So my question is, can machines be taught to do the same? And my answer is yes. So as one of the earlier sessions by Sachin, whoever has attended it, he asked us a question: is automation going to take our job? Right? And the answer is no. But I'd like to say, if I can teach my machine to summarize text for me, that means I'm being made redundant. We already have seen, you know, very complicated machine learning models, deep neural nets, that can write content better than a human being, that can write poetry, that can write any other prose. So as writers, like, are we threat of losing our jobs? I would say not in the next 5 to 10 years, but after 10 years, yes. It's a very big possibility. So as content authors, as content creators, what should we do? The only way is to upscale ourselves and spot the trends, go with the trends. So my main job is to show you how we can summarize the information from a body of text, because as human beings, it is impossible for me to. So as organizations are getting smaller and smaller and smaller, and we are taught to do more with less, so the challenge is, I can't scan through thousands of blogs, thousands of, you know, news content, thousands of articles and summarize them, right? It's just impossible. And I can't expect one person or two persons to scan through like 10,000 blogs and summarize content in, say, 2 days. It's just impossible. So the only solution is machine learning. We teach a machine how to do that. And this is what I'm going to talk about in the next half an hour or so. So this is what we have in automatic text summarization. So basically, we take huge blocks of text and then we summarize it in 3 sentences or 4 sentences or less. How do we do that? So as human beings, yeah. So how do you do that? If I can ask you a question. How do we do that? How do we summarize? What intuition do we follow? What thought process do we follow in summarizing that? Can anyone tell me? Sorry? Could you be more And how do you know? How do you know which keywords to pick up?
Context.
And how do you know which context to pick up? Yeah. Okay. So if I give you a blog, okay, that's an 800 word blog, for example. So, for example, it could be any event. Say this STC event, right? Someone wrote a blog on STC event. 800 word blog. So how would you summarize it? Say in 60 words or less. So as human, we have our own interpretation. So we pick up, say, the 10 top sentences that we want to. That makes more sense, that has more meaning. We rank them
And then out of the top 10, say we pick up like 4 to 5, which is a clear representative of the entire body of text. So that's how we're conditioned to do that. We read, we go through it, whatever makes sense we pick up, whatever doesn't we throw. And that's how we do it, basically. But again, I said, right, it's extremely time consuming. Reading a blog, let alone 800 word, reading even a, what, I don't know, 200 word blog, probably I'll take 6 hours, right? I'll just read it like 2 minutes at a time. That's what we do. So if you open up any, I mean, go to your desktop, sorry, go to your laptops, open up Chrome, you'll have probably have like what, 30 tabs open at the same time. Right, if I'm not mistaken. Most of us, we want to read something, open that up, forget about it, open another tab, then we kind of skim over things, right? So as humans, we do that a lot. But again, why should we do this if it takes a lot of time? We have automation to do that. We can train a machine to do exactly that, right? So basically, this is what I've said. This I've just put up in the slide. So it takes up, it interprets, extracts the relevant information, then it creates a summary representation, and whatever language it scans through, it provides it to you. But it's easier than it seems. So what happens in the background is actually there's a lot of statistics, there's a lot of math that happens, a lot of weightage is given to it, as ma'am said, a lot of keyword weightage is given, and depending on the keywords, it does keyword matching and then forms its own, you know, importance of the particular sentence. So that's why we see that. So if you open up CNN, for example, cnn.com or NBC, whatever. So if you open up any CNN article, on the left or the right side, I'm not sure, it gives you a summary of that particular, you know, news. So if I want to know like what Donald Trump is doing these days, I just click on anything that says Donald Trump, and his shenanigans are listed right either right on the left in 3 or 4 sentences. And that's how I know. For anyone here into digital marketing, content marketing, anyone? Social media marketing, no, right? So for example, say you've written a fantastic technical article and you want to, you know, promote that. And either you want to promote that on Twitter or on your company Facebook page or on your company Instagram page, whatever. So Facebook or say Twitter, let's take Twitter. So what do you do normally? So you go there, and how do you know what to write so that it, you know, catches the attention of your followers? That's where text summarization comes into picture. Why should I worry about that? Why not let the machine take care of that? And it gives you exactly what you need to write into Twitter. Right? So this is in a nutshell what basic text summarization is. So as I said again, why do you want to create summaries, right? Because it's like more and more text data and we have less and less time. As companies are shrinking, there's more pressure on people like us, right? So imagine what was the techcom community in your offices, right? What it was like 5 years ago and what it is now. There's been like a massive change. I mean, do you agree or not? Right? So we are constantly, you know, asked to do more with less, right? So that's why if you want to have to create summaries of what you are writing, if you are, say, you want to, whatever you have created, I want to send it to my the director of technology, whatsoever, I can probably use this algorithm to extract what I have done and send it to him or her. So the world is full of text data. Every day we have, I don't know, in a month probably zettabytes of text data come into the web. So it's very, very difficult for us to, you know, make sense out of all these things. So that's why we need, and of course we want to optimize readability. That's why we need summarization. So probably the next slide will give you a clearer picture what I said. So if I can show you this, it's not the best, you know, representation of it, but I somehow, you know, created it. So we have text summarization. We have, based on the input type, either I can have one document, summarize one document, or you have like summarizing multiple documents at the same time. Right. So if you like search on Google, anything, that metadata, right, that comes in along with your search is exactly this. Summary of that particular document. So Google has recently updated their search algorithm called BERT, B-E-R-T. Okay, so it's based on a deep neural network, bidirectional deep neural network. So now it has become very, very natural language based. So earlier it was not, the search results were there, but it wasn't performing that well. Right now, BERT can actually identify your intent and your context. Suppose you are searching for, you have put an input search string, well, I want a Jaguar, right? Google has to know whether it's the car or the animal, right? So based on your intent, it will give you the right search results. It will see or check your intent, whether you are a biologist or, you know, Jaguars are pretty expensive cars, so I'm assuming that only like the CEOs or even the directors buy it. So they will again identify your intent and context and will give you the right search results. So that's what BERT does. But again, what it does under the hood, it does algorithmically, it gives you the right, it summarizes your intent and then produces the search results. So for example, we have either single or multi document as inputs, and the outputs based on the input type, it could be extractive or abstractive. I'll come to that. What do we mean by extractive summarization or abstractive summarization? And now based on the content, the computation is done, whether it's a domain specific or a query based. So if you have worked with NoSQL databases, Mongo and DynamoDB, for example, so if you want to get results, you write a query, right? So again, deep in the heart of MongoDB, in the Mongo compiler, what it does is it, whatever you type in, it parses through, it creates a dependency graph and then stitches it through and gives you the results. That's what it does. So I'll just walk through the slides. It's not that important here. But what I want more is, my aim is to give you the importance of text summarization and how it will impact us now and in the future, and how can we really improve on it more. So this is a brief history of text summarization. It started way in like 60 years ago, P. Baxendale. So it was like pretty vanilla what he did. Of course, like 1959, we did not have any tech, so it was all completely by hand using basic summary statistics and basic mathematics. So what he did was like pretty good, very hard coded, but it was giving the results which were good at that time. Then we had the Learns method using frequency of content terms. So anyone attended Sachin's session in the morning, automation and tech writing? When we say frequency of content terms, exactly what he was talking about when you when we create a glossary. Pick up the terms minus the stop words and create a frequency table. So again, frequency of content terms, how important or how frequent that term is to that particular document, it used to calculate. Again, 1959, tech wasn't there virtually, so very low tech method of doing that. So then someone, Edmondson, so he did a positional frequency based summarization, which was slightly more complicated, but again nothing that a machine, I mean, so you couldn't model and do that. Then we had Frump, and then in somewhere in the mid 90s we really had a giant leap when it came to NLP and text summarization. So that's when we had the first trainable model, you know, training set and the test set. Then we had like proper usage of naive Bayes classifier, use proper classification of text. So it's really happened in the mid 90s. Then of course, after in 1998, Google came into picture, right? And that's when like Larry Page and Sergey Brin, they really stepped up the search. So somewhere in around 2000, Google deployed their first page rank algorithm. You know, it's named after Larry Page. He created it while he was a doctoral student at Stanford. So Google PageRank at that time was like a game changer. So algorithm was very complex, but the way it worked, Google PageRank was like top of the game at that. So we had so many browsers at that time, so many search engines at that time, right? The turn of the millennium. Google, of course, was there. We had, I don't know, Alta Vista, if anyone remembers, Alta Vista, Lycos. Yeah, AskJeeves and Yahoo, of course, all tanked because Google had such a fantastic algorithm at that time, PageRank algorithm, right? So how did they do that? So I want you to, you know, go back home today, just read about PageRank algorithm. It's so very interesting, so very intriguing how they did that way back like 25 years ago, right? So again, many iterations came for text summarization. So even you can completely ignore that, right? So now I'm coming to what the main, no? So again, it's an irony because I'm talking about text summarization and I did not summarize my, you know, presentations the way I wanted to. So there's been a big gap. So we have like extractive and abstractive summarization. So extractive is like pretty straightforward. Scan through sentences, give weight, take the keywords out, match the keywords to the sentences, take out an importance measure, weight them out according to order and the score, take the top three, that's the summary. That's what is extractive summarization. Abstractive summarization is actually more natural language based. So it's more human-like summaries. The way we want to paraphrase a content, that exactly abstractive summarization does. So if you deploy an algorithm, abstractive summarization, to a body of text, you might find that the top three sentences that the algorithm has returned, it's nowhere exists in the original document. Because it's been trained in such a way that it understands natural language or human-like behavior. And this is something that's very, very important. And not a lot of companies apart from Google and Microsoft, you know, the top five or top six tech companies have actually cracked it. Not only, I mean, they have not yet cracked it. I mean, a lot of research is still going on. So the day abstractive summarization actually, you know, becomes very mainstream, right, it'll create a lot of difference. It will be a game changer in the, you know, NLP world. So again, my intent here is actually not to make you very apprehensive, but a lot of places, you know, a lot of news websites, right? So a lot of news websites, CNN, IBN Live, or CNN, NDTV, Aaj Tak, you know, all those channels. So they have people who actually write those summaries manually. The day this becomes mainstream, they will become redundant, those people. Because already the AI is doing such a fantastic job of extracting summaries out of large body of text. So again, how am I doing on the time? It's good, right? Cool. So any questions before I move on? Okay, sure. Great question.
When we talk about summarization, so does it mainly concentrate on one type of guide, or how do we tackle?
Okay, I can't tell you about the type of guides because so don't quote me on that. For example, you are writing a very conceptual document. All right. For example, the concept of, I don't know, whatever, could be you're writing about an algorithm that your system is using. Right. So it's for a very technical audience. You are writing a technical white paper. Right. So when you're writing a technical white paper, it has a lot of statistics, a lot of performance benchmarking, you know, and it's catered to a particular audience. For example, some product management guy or a marketing manager from product marketing wants to, you know, somehow leverage that white paper, and he wants to use whatever is there on the white paper to sell his product, or, you know, to present it to the senior executives. So a marketing manager, a product manager, for example, he won't read through the entire white paper, right? So that's where you use summarization. I'm sure you are all using data, right? So in data, I think, correct me if I'm wrong, I haven't used it in a long, long time now. So correct me if I'm wrong, there's something called a short description, short desk, right? What is a short description?
Summary of the...
Exactly. So instead of writing a short description by yourself, we need to let the algorithm take care of it. All right. So I have written my concept, I've written my everything. So I just run an algorithm. It will scan through each file, take out the summary, put it there. And it will be helpful for the search engines as well, right? That's one use case where, you know, tech comm authors can leverage.
Just extrapolating from the example that you gave for text summary, see, as an author of a white paper, I'm the one who knows the subject matter at that time.
Sure.
So it makes it easier for me to provide an abstract summary rather than the text summary. So do an extractive abstract, but it's up to me to provide. I mean, I know how to write an abstract summary for that particular white paper.
Sure.
Right?
Sure.
So as you said, a marketing person could pick up either of these methods to create a summary.
Mm.
Which may not, I mean, depending on the algorithm or whatever he does, uses, it might not present the right picture.
Of course.
So in that case, basically defeats the purpose of the summary, one. And the second point that you kind of, since you brought it up, about the short description stuff.
Mm-hmm.
If you notice the morning session, you could also write a document using the automation stuff. So when you're automating the short description, it makes it easier to, I mean, you could just expand it to write the document for yourself, right?
True, absolutely. There are many use cases. See, as I said, summarization is not 100% foolproof, it's not yet bulletproof actually. There are big holes. Okay. So that's where we come in, right? Whatever the machine has returned, it's like just what, 60% accurate. Your job, my job, everyone's job is to make bridge that other 40%. That's where we come in.
So do we do machine learning to use machine learning to update? Because we do such a thing. We are trying to build a summarizer for our search engines.
We have to use machine learning for that. I mean, there is no way out. I mean, there's no alternative, right? So again, it's a double-edged sword. So for example, you are creating a knowledge base, right, for your support agents. So if you can, you know, automate, create summaries of all KB documents, right? So when a support agent types in a search query error, whatever, 404 not found, right? It's a very, very common thing. Instead of, if we don't have proper extraction, a proper summarization of what you have written below the metadata, that's okay. So it becomes very, very difficult for them to, you know, identify. So it becomes very, very difficult to pick up the right KB document and serve customers in a better way. Again, now abstractive summarization, if I come to that, people are still working on it. And actually, because I wanted to, you know, show you a couple of demos, I had prepared it for the last conference. Okay, but due to the infrastructure constraints, I mean, it's not possible, but you can very well do that in Python. There are various NLP libraries in Python. You can do that in R, you can do it in Julia, whatever. So it's you. So that's why, I mean, we need summarization, actually. And there are so many use cases of using text summarization. If you go to any industry, for example, you want to, you know, you have been selected as a doctoral student in, say, IIT Madras. Okay. Your guide will ask you, okay, whatever your subject is, get me, like, find, read everything there is about that particular subject. Go through research papers, go through IEEE papers, you know. It's difficult, right, to go through. So that's why if you look at the summary, this paper talks about this, that paper talks about that, you can very well create a picture in your mind that, hey, this is what my guide is asking for. Another big, you know, anyone working in patents? No. In patent industry, for example, you want to file a patent, right? So you want to see, before filing a patent, you want to see what all patents are already existing. You don't have time to go through all the patents, right? You want to see what the summary is for each patent. That's why we have text summarization for each patent, right? I know, because I recently filed a patent and we had to do the exact thing that I'm just talking to you about. Also, so how would you bring that in the tech docs industry, right? Every day we write a lot of, guides, reference guides, you know, any other, you know, artifacts. So if we want to have a better impact, we want our whatever we write, if we want to create a proper impact to our end users. See, we don't want to create something and we don't want our end users not to read what we have created, right? Otherwise the entire purpose is defeated, right? For example, I've given you examples. So that's why we need summarization to actually give you a summary to my reader or the end user. Hey, this topic is talking about this. So I can read it and ignore the rest of the suggestions. And this becomes very, very important. Netflix, right? For example, Netflix, Prime, Hotstar, Disney Plus, you name it. They have, so whichever movie that you want to, you know, watch, they give you recommendations. But how do you know what the movie is all about? Right? Summarization. Text summarization. Recommendation. So you want to buy something from Amazon or Flipkart, right? You get a great deal on a mobile phone. I want to see like what the others are saying. So I think on Flipkart or Amazon, I'm not sure. So they give you the top 5 pros and the top 5 cons. If you want to see a mobile phone, how do they do that? They parse each comment from the user, do NLPs, and they list out based on the weightage of the keywords, top 5 pros and top 5 cons. So that's how I know whether I want to buy an iPhone 11 or OnePlus, whatever. Okay. That's another big, big, you know, application of summarization in the, you know, e-commerce industry. Because the lines are blurring. So as like tech talks, tech authors, content creators, so don't think of yourself as technical authors. When you think yourself as like technical author, you are being very restricted to a pretty particular set of words. Think of yourself as a content producer, content creators, right? So as Sachin had said earlier, right, be part of the global product design strategy. When you start thinking about content producers, so you become more, you know, plugged into the overall product design strategy. How you can add value to it? Better summarization of what you are doing. Right. So any questions? No? At this point? Sure.
We have 5 minutes.
Could you speak to the mic? So sorry.
You might have to repeat yourself.
Earlier in your session, you said that maybe over 5 or 10 years, this machine learning could take over the human jobs. And now you just quoted that it's only 60% reliable, 40% right job you have to do.
Right now.
So how, I mean, it's contradicted.
No, right now it is.
Okay, again.
But in 10 years time, it will be like 90%.
And that 40%, I think, how much reliable is the summary? Because sometimes it happened that the content is not your intention is not completely came into the summary what you wanted to say. Yes. That can happen because at the end it's artificial intelligence.
Yes. So
human
right now
emotions, it will never overcome that thing.
See, right now it's only working at about 60% of its, you know, mileage, right? The day it touches 85% or 90%, then we have to worry about it. So,
and what actions we are doing for that? What will make it happen to go it to 85%?
The machine will do that, 80-85%. What you are asking, how we can bridge the gap?
That's what I am saying. At the end, we have to learn the machine what I want from it.
Yes, machines are learning already. Already they are learning. And they are learning better than us.
Yeah, that's right.
Right? So the machines are coming actually. I mean, there's no other way to sugarcoat it. Machines are coming after us all, right? So the only way out is to like upskill ourselves every time. So one of my managers at Adobe, he straight away one day told us, you don't think yourself as writers, don't think yourself as authors, think as like data scientist. How a data scientist tackles a problem. The day we identify that how to, you know, get whatever we create to the right set of people at the right way, your job is done. The machines will be rendered useless here, right? So think, don't, you know, restrict yourself as being like technical authors, right? Get out of that mold. Think yourself as content producers, content creators, part of a larger product design group, part of a larger product management group. think yourself as an analytics expert. How would I provide analytics to better understand what my customer wants? So if you write a content, for example, map out the complete customer journey. How is reaching the content, and from your content, where is he or she is going to, right? So I'm going a little bit off topic here, but my, you know, the crux of the matter is, in order to get that maximum, create that maximum impact for my user, so that my user can look at my summary and then decide, hey, this is something I should read at, this is something worth reading. Your summary should create the maximum impact, right? So that's what we need machines to do, that at a large scale. I can't do, you know, summarize content for like what, thousands and thousands of articles, right? That's where we come in, fine tune it more, we refine it more. And that's how we learn, machines learn. Right. So this is how critical it is. Right now, again, in 5-10 years, it'll be a game changer. It'll be a completely different, you know, environment, completely different landscape, what we are right now. So the only way out is to, you know, upscale yourself here. Think big. I mean, yes, someone said, right, go big or go home. That's it. So thank you, everyone. If you have any more questions, I can make sure. Can you hand over the mic? No problem. It's good that the laptop hour went. I had only like one more slide after that. I had only prepared like what, 10 slides for a 30-minute thing. So yeah,
may not be relevant, but
no problem,
just checking. So do we have some kind of a tool or something where we could just run a URL to see a summary? Do we have something?
Yes,
right now
we have, we can have you? A few tools, but only do like extractive ones.
Just to get that.
Yes, there are three or four tools. I don't know, you have to Google it out.
Okay.
There are two.
But there are, right? I mean, if then, we want, like for example, I'd create a topic and I push it to my help portal and I just want a summary out for my, just to see, maybe, as you said, just check against what I have documented. Is that something we could just do as a POC, right?
There are. But if you really want to, you know, create an impact, I would ask, you know, go to your, you know, organization's, you know, data science team and your machine learning engineers. Give them the problem statement, ask them to create an abstractive summarization model.
Okay.
So you might have to train whatever you've written for 1 month.
Right.
Train the model. And how well you train your model will depend on how well the model will behave down the line. Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm-hmm.
So that's something that you can create a proposal, go to your data science teams and say, hey, build me something like this. This is the research I've done.
Right. So just
you can create a summary of what you have done. And you can present.
Cool. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much, Saurav, for the interesting topic on automatic text summarization.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure. And I would like to invite Sangeeta to the dais so that she could hand over the momentum to Saurav. Big round of applause to Saurav.
Thank you.
There are two announcements I have to give you, so please stay back so that I can announce those and then you can go for your respective tracks or you can remain in the same track. Okay, the first announcement is, you know, there's a trip on